what's going to happen. So, sympathy groups, we realized that there was nothing and no one looking after us from the level that we were on. There were big groups, name dropping, CHOP for example, who were there, but they had social workers, not us. They were never told, your child, this innocent, beautiful child that you brought into the world and did everything for and will do everything for, now has cancer, and odds are, in Africa, your child will probably die. And as a mother faced with that, I can tell you from experience, I don't want to listen to someone teaching me what to do if they haven't been there. I want to have someone who walked the road, who cried the tears, who cursed everyone, who screamed at everyone, who almost had, you know, the divorce and everything because of the stress in this family. And if you don't have that, in my opinion, I don't see how, you know, groups can work if you don't have that experience working for you. And then just coming to everyone in public health, please, I have a lot of understanding that the mommy groups on Facebook are, mommy groups are horrible. They, yeah, most of it can't be trusted. But please teach your students, your everyone, sometimes you can trust mommy groups. We sometimes know what we're talking about, and then when we want to help, we find a lot of times that the doctors are, I wouldn't say they feel threatened by us, they just feel it's dismissive. You know, what do you know anyway? You know, go raise your child. And that is a big problem in, well, we are in the whole Western Cape, of feeling disempowered while trying to make a difference. And, you know, what do you do in the end? Then we get together and we drink tea.
just that's a brilliant story. I'm going to quote that because I think it absolutely illustrates the point. But your point is about the power of relations, and the one thing about syndicates is you don't professionalize them. I mean, I thought initially we would go, you know, use nurses or midwives or whatever. And Lisa Howard Bradman rang me up and said, no, don't do that. And we went through elaborate things to set, you know, the local women, people who were part of that. They have to be a beneficiary themselves. And I think your story is very powerful because cancer, one of the other things I did at WHO was try to get something moving around strengthening. Because there are a lot of not just preventable, but treatable cancers now. And they don't, you know, people don't get the services in the same way they don't get insulin in many countries. And a lot of this has to be a match of the supply side to the demand side. People who suffer this, autism, what's the... The only groups I know in Nepal, for example, are parent groups who are coming together and they will drive the services. So, thank you, it's brilliant.
Thank you so much.
I'll take two quick ones.
And then we have time where, despite, he won't make it to a soccer match, but we will have some time for refreshments, so there'll be an opportunity.
Yeah, no, I won't rush off. And Belgium will win anyway.
So two quick questions, and maybe
My name is Catherine Dantlis. I'm a PhD student at Karolinska University in Sweden. I'm doing my research in Kenya on HIV and KMCT. And what you're mentioning here, I was so inspired with, I'm looking at a lot of the mental mothers, as well as the mental mother system, where PM mothers are sort of teaching other women in the same situation how to adhere to the medication, how to take care of their children. And the big problem is you have financing. It's lacking a lot of energy from the Kenyan government, but it's highly effective.
Yeah.
And the women are paid less to nothing. And how do we, as scientists, how do we try to raise that gap of what they actually contribute and what they receive in return, given the effect of the gap, the social edge?
Mm-hmm. That's a really important question. The limits of volunteerism, and before you then get into remuneration. I can tell you what we did, but let's take the other question.
Yeah, just very quick. My name is Katie Ferreira. I'm a lecturer in nutrition here at PwC, and I'm doing my PhD in public health. And thank you very much for a very constructive and a lot of information in the presentation. I was just interested in why you've chosen to use the word sympathy groups as opposed to just saying groups or community groups or empathy groups. Because sympathy kind of evokes sorry for people, journalism.
A lot of people have said different things to me about this. And I used it because that's what Dunbar uses. Mm-hmm. So I was drawing upon a cultural anthropologist who's internationally known who came up with that. And it might, even if it captures the imagination and leads to a debate, that might not be a bad thing. I thought of shifting it to empathy groups. It sounded a bit light on, because sympathy does have specific, different historical meanings. That could be, what was the other one you suggested?
Community, or just...
Yeah, groups. I think community groups is a broader, it's a genus of which sympathy group is one. So I'm using it from the anthropologists, but I take your point. But you can still read the book. Yeah, but back to the book. So, we used initially paid facilitators because they were working 3 or 4 days a week and we paid them at the government rate. But then we quickly moved on more to volunteers, but we remunerated them as an incentive for extra work they did, mobilizing people to come to the groups. But we then gave them a very light workload, so they would do one or two. Your previous speaker, Sundararaman, talks a lot about this, and he said, for volunteers, you might expect a volunteer to work 3 or 4 hours a week. That's fine. Anything more than that, you should remunerate them for lost income or whatever. So you have to get the balance right. The problem of professionalizing it too much is you get into the problems that you said there, that it then becomes instructional and not being part of that group. So it's a tricky one. And we're not trying to turn them into health workers. That's the mistake. The ASHA, there are 900,000 accredited social health activists in India, and they're trying to move towards being health workers, and actually I think they should probably stay as that. But you can reward them in other ways, like the respect, like getting preference for election, and other things, and most people want to do it. You know, I'm in a book group, and they don't blame me.
I'll elaborate.
But no, let's talk about that, because you have to get that line. I think it's an important one.
Thank you very much, Tony. I can see there are a couple of other people.
So I'll be around.
You'll be engaged in many sympathy conversations. I want to thank, just briefly, all the audience, our winter school participants and faculty who really make this time. Everyone else in Cape Town goes away, but we double down here at the School of Public Health, and it's a really critical time. I'm glad you could be here for that. I wanted to thank, obviously, our honored guests, our rector, Professor Tyrone Pretorius, for being here, David Saunders, for whom this lecture is named after, as well as our HOD and other faculty members. And also, most importantly here, this time is a very intense time at UWC. I want to thank... I want to thank the staff at UWC, Tamlin Peterson in particular, who pulled this program together, but all the staff here who make sure the logistics behind this huge endeavor. There are 5 classes or so every week, making sure the materials are there, food is there, everything runs on time, you know, makes lecturing for us a joy to be with our students. But it's really the support from the broader school in the background that really makes all the lectures, but also everything else happen. So a huge thank you to all of them there, they're sitting in the background. And obviously the National Research Fund, the NRF, for funding this research chair and enabling us to bring you here. And I wanted to give you a token to say thank you to you. And so that it is winter here in Cape Town, even though it's wonderfully warm. But so that you have School of Public Health always with you.
Thank you very much.
invite you just to come outside. There's someone there, if you have a chance to.